Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to On the Town. We ended last year with over 300 celebrities appearing on this show, but this year our quest is 500 celebrities. And for the first show of the new year, we have quite a beginning. Inside is 100 celebrities from the golden age of television for the last 40 years. And it's the biggest party in Hollywood this week. So I'm going to take you, our television audience, to this party. You'll see me walk in, we'll show you a lot of the faces that are here, and then we'll do some personal interviews with those people. So you know right now you're on the town with Mike Farah. Let's go. Let's take you to that party. As I start my first interview today at our quest for 500 stars this year, I guess I'm starting at the top because who I have with me, Johnny Grant, is the honorary mayor of Hollywood. And when you see the Santa Claus Lane Parade, when you see parades like the salute to the servicemen after the...
Well, that was a welcome home desert storm. Yeah, that was the biggest single day event in the history of L.A. because the people were really in the mood to come out and... Mm-hmm. And thank the men and women of the armed forces. That was a rolling pageant of patriotism. I had a great time.
You know, I only go back with this young man about 40 years.
You're not that old.
40 years I've known him, but I was lucky enough, as you who watch the show know, that I grew up in Toluca Lake, and we had some
I'm going to tell him what he did. He used to work for the package store and delivered my booze to me when I couldn't walk over to the store to get it.
And a few others, too, along the way.
We won't mention their names. But that's a long time ago.
Our neighborhood has some great stars.
Yeah.
Of course, our most famous one down the street from, I grew up on Moore Park, so you knew who.
Bob Hope. Yeah. Robert Hope.
And you had, when you think about just the talent, and you know the best part is what I really admire about Johnny has really kept Hollywood going all these years. When I say kept going.
Well, we've had a lot of help.
There's been a lot of help.
Everybody wants Hollywood to survive. There's a few naysayers out there, and damn them, I say. But we're going to, it's turning around, and this is probably the most famous name in the whole world,
yes.
Hollywood. I mean, certainly one of the most famous, and it draws such emotion.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's negative, but most of the time it's positive. You get on an airplane and somebody says, where are you from? And you say, North Carolina. They say, well, that's a nice state. You say you're from Hollywood, and you better be prepared to talk the rest of
the
trip.
Right. Well, now that we have Johnny on, he's got to be prepared to talk with us.
Only a few minutes. I've got people waiting. So
we're going to make you stay right here because let's talk about the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
Well, ask me. I'll talk.
I mean, let's talk about the beginning of it.
I went there at the beginning.
But also, what you're doing there now, because you've got great stars coming in every 2 weeks now. I mean, I've seen you got Christopher Reeves, who was just here a couple of months ago, you put in there. You've got some great entertainers. And now it's just as big today as it was before. I mean, it's growing.
Well, it had its bad days back during the Vietnam era when Hollywood and a lot of communities around the world had problems, but Hollywood is coming back. The Walk of Fame is very hot. The Hand and Footprints, I do those ceremonies too.
Mm-hmm.
The Walk of Fame started in 1959 and actually was dedicated in 1960.
Mm-hmm.
And they put in 1,500 stars at that time.
Right.
And we do a couple a month now. And Criteria for a star on the Walk of Fame is professional achievement, longevity of 5 years, and most important, what you've given back to the community. So that's the way that works. And as I say, we do a couple a month. There are a lot of people that should have been put in there when the first ones went in. Mm-hmm. But like all awards, there'll be a lot of people who earn them and deserve them that will never get them. And mm-hmm. I'm sorry for that.
You know, Johnny, you've been spearheading the rebirth of Hollywood and rebuilding it. You've got a museum there now, don't you?
And then there's a couple of museums. There's the Hollywood Entertainment Museum. Mm-hmm. I don't know what's going to happen to the barn. I keep, trying to find out if they're ever going to reopen the old barn, the DeMille Lasky barn.
Right.
There was no movies ever shot in there. It was mm-hmm. just a storage barn, and it was DeMille's office. But that's a part of the early days of Hollywood,
right.
And we should put a lot of stuff in there. Then the old Max Factor building is going to be made into the Hollywood History Museum. A young lady by the name of Dee Dee Dadigan is doing that. She's spending her own money, mm-hmm. and I think the community and any celebrities or mm-hmm. families of celebrities watching in, if you have stuff you want to display, we need to keep it in Hollywood.
Right.
And I can assure you she's a very honest lady and is going to have a successful museum there.
I think anyone who goes to Hollywood today and stands at that hotel where your offices are in the Hollywood Chamber of Commerce and just looks across the street at the Chinese Theater, there's no doubt in your mind that Hollywood is a magic word.
That's beginning. There's a whole new $300 million project taking place there. Mm-hmm. And you're going to be surprised, but it's going to happen. And they'll be building around the Chinese Theater.
Mm-hmm.
Some of the newer theaters, the little ones, will be torn down and larger ones built. But it's going to be jumping there. The boulevard is cleaned up, and we're very happy with the progress we've made, but have a lot more to go.
Well, you know, surprisingly enough, if you look at parades, and you look at the Macy Parade, if there's any parade that you can compare anything to, or the Rose Parade, you talk about the Hollywood Lane Parade.
Well,
that's a tradition.
You're behind now. It's called the Santa Claus. It's the Hollywood Christmas Parade.
Well, for those who are here, it's always Hollywood
to be,
Lane.
Well, it used to be the Santa Claus Lane Parade. It's a Hollywood Christmas Parade. I just finished my 20th one, so I'm mm-hmm. through. I have finished my assignment with that, and I wish everybody good luck. If there's any way I can help them, I'm going to be here to do it, but I think you should have some new blood in there, some new mm-hmm. ideas. It'll be on a new station, so good luck to them. That is one of our great traditions.
I want to tell a little trivia story about a friend of yours, Gene Autry.
Well,
he saw the kids and all that lined up for Santa Claus one year early on in that parade,
mm-hmm.
and looked out there and decided to write a song watching the parade and the kids waiting, and that here comes Santa Claus. And
right.
He wrote it that night watching the parade and the kids anticipating. Of course, that went on to be a great Christmas standard.
Well, that too, and Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer only got recorded because they had 15 minutes left over at a recording session, and mm-hmm. Ina Autry says, you got to do a little Rudolph. And he did it in one take, and it became even bigger than Here Comes Santa Claus. With that, I got to do like Santa and dash off on my way, so thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
Thank
you. Know, what a way to start a show with Johnny Grant, Honorary Mayor of Hollywood.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, my
Bye-bye.
Friend Johnny.
Have a good one. Thank
Bye-bye.
You very
much.
Back to Toluca Lake.
We started our quest this year for 500 celebrities, and we started with the Honorary Mayor of Hollywood, but now we are technically really in North Hollywood, Universal City, and we have the Honorary Mayor of North Hollywood here, but even more so, the proprietor of the hotel, our hostess.
Right.
And most of the younger crowd knows you from the mother on My Three Sons,
mm-hmm.
but you really didn't start in television, and why don't we go back to where you started in theater?
Well, let's see, I started a little in Summer Stock, and because I needed to get my equity card, mm-hmm. and then I went down to Laguna, and I did a little theater in Laguna,
mm-hmm.
and then an agent saw me and asked if he could handle me, but I had, I'd done a lot of theater mm-hmm. in the round, and so I said, fine, and he got me my first movie called DOA, Dead on Arrival with Eddie mm-hmm. O'Brien, and so I did that, and then, some things happened, and I finally ended up going. I did a lot of movies. I did The Joker's Wild with Frank Sinatra. Right. And then I went to New York because they asked me if I would do a television show. Mm-hmm. And the television show was called Decoy, the story of a New York policewoman. And I went back and I tested for it, and I did it. And they went 39 shows, and then they ran out of money, and so that was the end of that. And they right. sold it syndication, so they didn't sell it in New York, and they didn't sell it in Los Angeles. And so after it was finished, I came back. Well, now mm-hmm. I had a red dot on my forehead, because in those days, you didn't do television
right.
if you were going to work in movies. Mm-hmm. So I could not work in any movies anymore.
Right.
I could only work on television. Mm-hmm. So I became a television child, and I did every pilot, you know, the Dr. Kildare pilot, and I did right. them all. And I did that for a long time, all the pilots. And then I met Roger Corman. I did a lot really? Of the horror movies.
Oh, yeah.
And then
how to film a movie in 5 days.
Absolutely. And then my next series was The Bing Crosby Show with Bing Crosby. I did mm-hmm. that. Then my next series was with My Three Sons with mm-hmm. Fred McMurray. I did that. After that, I played Stephanie's mother on Remington Steele with right. Pierce Bronson. I played her mother. After I did that, I played Scarecrow and Mrs. King, Katie Jackson's mom in right. Scarecrow and Mrs. King. And the last series was Terry Hatcher's mother in The New Adventures of Superman.
So this is your typecasting as the mother?
Yes, I'm the mother. I'm the mother. I'm always the mother. Mm-hmm. I got into the mother as on My Three Sons, and I haven't gotten mm-hmm. out of the mother role.
Well, you know, that's what I think more people remember you for that. And, you know, today with our group, we actually have the stepsons on the show.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they're all here. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Beverly, one of the movies you did was with Frank Sinatra. Mm-hmm. Does that mean you were hanging around the Rat Pack?
Well, I mean, you know, that was the story of Joey Lewis, and Joey right. Lewis was there. And there really wasn't a Rat Pack, but I got to tell you, I think anybody that went around with Sinatra was kind of like a Rat Pack, because right. everybody, you know, you'd go out with them, all these guys, mm-hmm. and they would sit down and they'd line up all, you know,
right.
the bourbon, the scotch, the vodka. The,
mm-hmm.
He is so fun to work with. He is so good. The only thing about Sinatra was that he did not ever, you know, he'd come on right. the set and he'd say, now where do we stand? We go here, we move there. Okay. You want to do, Frank, can we just do that once? Yeah, okay, I move here, I can move there, okay, and then my line is, no, okay, bye. That's it, that's all we got. That's all the rehearsal we get, period. That's when you're ready to shoot it, shoot it.
We, one of the movies, we had Ruta Lee on.
She's my friend.
And we actually did the Thalian Ball with Ruta and Debbie Reynolds and Carol Channing.
Yeah.
It was a great show, I thought, and we got a lot of requests for that show, and Ruta was such a character. I was with her at a private party and asked her about, she worked on Sergeants 3.
Yeah.
And
She and I were on Stump the Stars together with Mike Stokey. I mean, we did that for almost 2 years.
When you talk about working with Sinatra, you also worked with another great legend, Bing Crosby.
Oh, yeah. Bing Crosby was wonderful. And, you know, it was very interesting because Bing Crosby wanted to do this show. We did a year, mm-hmm. and then he took it off. He didn't want to do it anymore. He was very disappointed that it didn't get the ratings it should have gotten. Mm-hmm. But it was fascinating working with him because, one, he had Buddy Cole mm-hmm. playing the piano every day. He cannot work right. without music. He has a photogenic memory. He'd come in the morning, and mm-hmm. he'd say, what are we going to do today? And I'd say, we're going to do no. And right. he'd look at it, and look at it, and look at it, and that was it. He knew it.
Right.
If you hummed any song, he knew the words mm-hmm. and the melody. He never forgot anything. It was incredible.
You know, it's funny, he really set the tone of what a crooner should be.
Oh, gosh.
Everyone who wanted to be a crooner really was trying to imitate
right.
Bing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, his voice sounded so natural when he sang.
Well, you know, not only did his voice sound natural, but, you know, I have a lot of those shows, and mm-hmm. he is the most natural actor.
Uh-huh.
You know, he's just so laid back,
right.
Crosby. He
kind
just
of
was.
Kind of Perry Como,
you know?
Was that
yeah,
way, too.
Yeah, laid back. You know, I'm sure that Bing Crosby wasn't always laid back.
Right.
But, by gosh, when he works, he's just so easy.
You know, it's funny. If you were to see just a picture of Bing Crosby,